Well, good morning, everybody. I'm assured, and thank you for your messages that you can see and hear me. So I'm not talking to myself in vain on this Palm Sunday. And I wish you a very warm welcome from wherever you're joining us from this morning. It's a bit wet and windy here in Accrington. I'm fully expecting that a dustbin might go flying past my window in a minute. But wherever you are, I hope you're safe and warm, and that our worship together this morning will join us together and build us in faith. It is Palm Sunday. It's the beginning of Holy Week, the most special week in the Christian calendar, as we journey through the week with Jesus on the road to suffering and then to glory next Sunday. We commemorate this day with our palm crosses. And you may have received one if we've been able to distribute one to you, but perhaps also you might have had the opportunity to make one or use something you've got at home. And we will be using those very shortly in our service. Because it's Holy Week, our normal activities are effectively suspended this week as we put on some special worship events for Holy Week, and details of those have been on the opening slides, and we've distributed them by email. Our special events start this afternoon at 4 o'clock with prayers and meditations to be led by Reverend Sarah. I hope you'll be able to join her, and then subsequent days through the week. And as we approach Maundy Thursday, there will be a special service of Holy Communion in the evening. And on Good Friday, that most solemn of days when we remember Jesus' suffering and crucifixion, there'll be a short open air service at St. James at 10:30. And at 2 o'clock online, there will be reflections on Stations of the Cross. Our church buildings are opening again for worship. St. James has been for a couple of weeks, and St. Stephen's opens today. So there will be services there at 9:30 and 10:30 next Sunday. The online service next week is Reverend Sarah's service that she leads, the multilingual service, with a special theme for Easter. And after Easter, in the 2 weeks following, Reverend Sarah and myself will be taking a break. So there will be some changes to our normal activities, and we'll keep you posted in due course. As I say, all the details will be on our Facebook page. So let us just pause as we begin this service and just set aside all the busyness and distractions of the day and come together now with our focus on God, who is always with us. And I'll be using some of the special liturgy for Palm Sunday, and please join in with me as the words appear on the slides. Join in the words in bold. Hosanna to the Son of David, the King of Israel. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. Thinking of the events of Palm Sunday, we acknowledge that we, like the crowds, were quick to abandon Jesus and follow our own desires. So let us ask God's forgiveness. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy on you. So may Almighty God have mercy upon you, pardon and forgive you from all your sins, and restore you to the fullness of life for which he created you. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters, during Lent we have been preparing by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today we come together to begin this solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters his own city to complete his work as our Saviour, to suffer and to die and to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love, so that united in his sufferings, we may share in his risen life. So if you have a palm cross, please would you take it in your hand. God, our Saviour, whose Son Jesus Christ entered Jerusalem as Messiah to suffer and to die, let these palms be a sign of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So we're going to hear now the Palm Gospel read to us by Reverend Sarah.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Mark chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. When Jesus and his disciples were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it,' and will send it back here immediately." They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is coming the kingdom of our ancestor, David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
So we can take our palms now, or our leafy branches, whatever we have, and join in worshipping as we sing our first hymn, make way, for Christ the King in splendour arrives.
Make way, make way, for the King of Kings.
So we join together now in the collect, the special prayer for today, and we say together, true and humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way of the cross, which is the path to glory. Amen. We're going to hear now the other readings set for this day. And first of all, Ian is going to read our psalm.
A reading from Psalm 31, verses 9 to 16. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I am in trouble. My eye is consumed with sorrow, my soul and my body also. For my life is wasted with grief, and my years with sighing. My strength fails me because of my affliction, and my bones are consumed. I have become a reproach to all my enemies, and even to my neighbours, an object of dread to my acquaintances. When they see me in the street, they flee from me. I am forgotten like one that is dead, out of mind. I have become like a broken vessel, for I have heard the whispering of the crowd. Fear is on every side. They scheme together against me and plot to take my life. But my trust is in you, O Lord. I have said, you are my God. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face to shine upon your servant, and save me for your mercy's sake. Lord, let me not be confounded, for I have called upon you. But let the wicked be put to shame, let them be silent in the grave. Let the lying lips be put to silence, that speak against the righteous with arrogance, disdain, and contempt. Here endeth the reading.
And our next reading is our epistle reading that Julie is going to read to us. We've had some problems with the sound quality on this. So I put the words up as well. The sound does come on partway through it. We've really struggled to get the sound right on this one, so we apologise.
But emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Julie and Ian. We are grateful to see and hear different voices for our readings. And on this Palm Sunday, it's traditional to read the Passion Gospel. So there will be quite a long Gospel reading now. So I hope you're sitting comfortably. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. hear the Passion Gospel according to Mark, chapter 15, beginning at verse 1. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" He answered him, "You say so." Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply. So Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during an insurrection. So the crowds came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then do you wish me to do with this man you call the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "Crucify him." Pilate asked them, "Why, what evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him." So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace that is called the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. And they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charges against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Are you who would build the temple, destroy the temple and build it in the 3 days? Save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom. Now when the centurion, who stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this was the Son of God." Here ends the Passion reading. May I speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Well, we've just heard in that Passion Gospel the events that will take us to Good Friday. But we aren't there yet. Here we are on Palm Sunday. And I'm going to focus just a few brief thoughts on the Gospel that Reverend Sarah read. For today, here we are with our palm crosses, with those crowds as Jesus entered Jerusalem. Maybe you've made your own palm cross, or you've got some leaves to wave in remembrance of this. If you've made one, perhaps you could put a picture on our Facebook page for us. But these palm crosses and our leaves remind us of the leafy branches the Gospel mentioned that they laid before Jesus as he rode into Jerusalem. The shadow of the events of the coming week will hang over him. And I'm reminded that this is our second Sunday of Palm Sunday in lockdown under the shadow of coronavirus that's been hanging over us. We may think we've lived and continue to live in volatile times with uncertainty and pain. It can seem like the world has been more volatile and uncertain than it's ever been. But 2,000 years ago, Jesus journeyed into Jerusalem, into the most volatile of times, fully charged. Everyone, it seemed, was on high alert. The Romans were keeping watch. They feared another uprising led by this itinerant leader from the rural outback of Galilee. We heard in the Passion Gospel that Barabbas was in jail because of another insurrection. And the Romans were right there on guard, ready to stamp out any upsurgence. Jerusalem was also packed with Passover pilgrims gathered to celebrate the most revered of Jewish festival, one in which they remembered their liberation from slavery in Egypt. And yet once again, here they were in slavery in their own land, under the occupation of the mighty fist of the Roman Empire. Perhaps their hope is on the one riding on the donkey. Would God, through him, liberate them once again? Their cries of Hosanna, which literally mean rescue us, save us, indicate that there was some hope in this man. And their welcome that they gave to him is that of a king sent by God. The Palm Gospel refers to a colt. Jesus told his followers to go and bring the colt. And perhaps his disciples and the owner, who was most compliant, would have been mindful of the prophecy in Zechariah. "Shout, O Lord, aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes, triumphant and victorious, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of the donkey." Surely they must have made the connections, and there would have been murmurings. Is this the one we've been expecting? But there is no uprising, no insurrection. Jesus is not interested in political power, earthly kingdoms, status, palaces, armies. He's not even come to start a new religion. His purpose is to bring life to all. John's Gospel says, I have come that you might have life abundantly. It's not a life that transports us away into some other utopia, away from the realities of this life. But it's a way of understanding and seeing the world, of relating to one another, and of hope and eternal hope and peace. Because it's a fullness of life that stems from knowing God as he's been revealed to us in Jesus Christ. The king who rides today on that colt offers not the comfort and assurance of an earthly kingdom, but of victory and peace, which he will secure for all people within a week through his cross and resurrection. And it's life in abundance that is offered openly and freely for all. Hope for this broken world and the restoration of a fractured relationship with God. In Jesus' humility and readiness to serve all of humankind, he teaches us what kingship is truly like. On this Palm Sunday, and as we journey into Holy Week, does this unlikely King of Glory find a welcome in our hearts? Are we today standing with the crowds, cheering him on and welcoming him, praising him? Or are we just observers and bystanders? In the days ahead, perhaps many like those in the crowds who were close on Palm Sunday will go on to abandon him and disown him as his own disciples did when the going got tough. But in a world which can seem volatile and uncertain and seemingly spiralling out of control, this humble Prince of Peace has much to teach us and brings a message of hope for all. May this King on the colt find our hearts open to him as we journey through Holy Week. Amen. So let us join together now in declaring our faith. Let us declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And as we turn now to God in prayer, Janet is going to lead us.
Let us pray. There is a response to the following prayers. When I say, let us pray to the Lord, could you please respond, Lord, have mercy. We stand with Christ in his suffering. We pray for forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For grace to seek out those habits of sin, which mean spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Christian people, that through the suffering of disunity, they may grow a rich union in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who make laws, interpret them and administer them, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who still make Jerusalem a battleground, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who have the courage and honesty to work openly for justice and peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in darkness and agony of isolation, that they may find support and encouragement. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who, weighed down with hardship, failure, or sorrow, feel that God is far from them. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who are tempted to give up the way of the cross, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Janet. So we come now to the sharing of the peace. Once we were far off, but now in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood, for he is our peace. So may the peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. So from our own places, let us offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you. So we turn now to the preparation of the table. Be present, Lord Jesus, and make yourself known in the breaking of bread. Jesus, true vine and bread of life, ever giving yourself that the world might live, let us share your death and passion. Make us perfect in your love. Amen. So we join in the words of the Eucharistic prayer. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with us. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. And now we give you thanks, because for our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself, and by his suffering and death become the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. On the night before he died, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them. Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us his body and blood. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We join now in the words of the prayer that Jesus taught us, in whichever language or version you prefer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we break the bread to show that Christ's body was broken for all, so that we might be united in him, we say together, every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be healed. Although we cannot partake physically, we join together spiritually in feasting on the body and blood of Jesus. We say together, Lord, you stand at the door of my heart and knock. You wait for me, and only I can let you in. I believe and trust in you and ask you now to fill me with presence. Feed me with your body and unite me in your blood, that I may be your blessing to a world in need. Amen. And I'm just going to play some music now so we can take a time to reflect on what Jesus has done for us. We say together now our post-communion prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, you humbled yourself in taking the form of a servant and in obedience died on the cross for our salvation. Give us the mind to follow you and to proclaim you as Lord and King to the glory of God the Father. Amen. We come now to our final hymn, which is that lovely Palm Sunday hymn, Ride On, Ride On in Majesty. What a great hymn for this special day. And just before we come to our final prayer of blessing, just a few thanks and reminders. I want to thank everybody who's joined me today and everyone who's taken part in our service, because it's so lovely to see different faces and hear different voices. I will put up the details about the worship during Holy Week on our Facebook page, and obviously that will impact on our normal events that take place. So please do have a look at that, and it would be lovely if you could join us in those events. And again, they're starting this afternoon at 4 o'clock. We will be having coffee and chat today after the service at 11:30, but for the next couple of weeks we'll be taking a break. And because Sarah and I are having a break, we will post on this Facebook page the changes that will arise to our normal events as a result of that. We know that restrictions are beginning to lift a little tomorrow, so perhaps you'll be able to meet up with somebody in your garden or in your household, with another household that you've not seen for some time. So we wish you every joy in that, and do keep safe and well. And if you've been having any celebrations in this last week or over the next couple of weeks, we share in your joy and send our blessings for that. So we just come now to our final prayer of blessing. May God the Father, who loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, bring you by faith to his eternal life. May Christ, who accepted the cup of sacrifice in obedience to the Father's will, keep you steadfast as you walk with him in the way of the cross. May the Spirit, who strengthens us to suffer with Christ, that we may share in his glory, set your minds on life and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you this day and always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen. So thank you, and look forward to joining with you in worship in this coming week. Thank you.